more about revivals from history, personal revivals, and then pressing in ourselves. It's been the theme so far of the small groups this summer. And I guess we may as well get the ball rolling with Zach. Come on, Zach. Zach Sloane, our resident theologian. Knock yourself out, Zach. You're going to speak to us on the history. History. There you go.
All right. Today, we're going to talk about the Reformation. Last week, we went 200-300 years back in history. This week, we're going to go even farther, 500 years. So next year, actually, will be the 500th anniversary of the Reformation, as they count it starting October 31st, 1517. But one thing I want to say before I start, something about history. When you go back in history and you want to look and see the things that have happened, the important, significant things, there's a couple of different ways to do it. And in the 1840s, there's a fellow called Carlyle, and he had this theory that if you want to understand history, what you need to do is look at the great men. So, and that's pretty common. You know, you look in textbooks and there's significant players, great people, the movers and shakers of the time. And he said, if you look at their lives, study them, understand what they're all about, then you understand the times. And, you know, we do that. You know, 20 years later, a fellow Spencer wrote a rebuttal and said, actually, no. He's like, if you want to understand history, you need to understand the society of the people who we call great, because nobody is great in and of themselves. It's the societal structures that make them great. So there's just been this argument throughout time. You know, how do we properly assess, look at history, and how do we take good things from it? And I would argue, too, there's a third way. And that's kind of the way I want to talk about the Reformation tonight, is because there's it's a big historical event, huge ramifications for the world. There's a whole bunch of ways you can study this. But I think about the Apostle Paul in Corinthians, and he had a very special relationship with the Corinthians. You know, at one point he says to them, you know, you've got lots of instructors, but you don't have many fathers. So he had a very special relationship with them. But he's always having to, he's in this awkward situation where he always has to defend his calling, his relationship to them. So he'd come to Corinth, or he'd send them a letter, and then these people would come in behind him and say, you know what, don't worry about Paul, he's weak, he's scrawny, he doesn't know what he's talking about, we're where it's at. So he, you know, some of the letters he's having to address this. And in 1 Corinthians 9, he does. He says, you know, am I not an apostle? Am I not free? Have I not seen the Lord Jesus Christ? You are my work in the Lord. And then in verse 2, he says, you are the seal of my apostleship. So the Apostle Paul made an appeal to his legacy and his work by the impact that he had on a group of people through relationship. And I want to argue that when we look at the Reformation, there's lots of different ways you can do it, but there was a distinct impact that Martin Luther, that the Reformers, and this whole move of God had on people and the way they related to God. And so that's what we're gonna look at tonight. But as we're speaking about great men, the Reformation, you know, is this thing that's happened all over Europe. So you can talk about people like John Calvin and Philip Melanchthon and Ulrich Zwingli, and but we will talk about Luther. That's the most famous story. So Martin Luther, in 1505, his family had arranged for him to go to law school. He's going to be a lawyer. And July of 1505, he's riding through a field, and there's a big thunderstorm that hits. And it must have been a big one, because it scared the pants right off of him. He hits the deck. He's so scared. And he does what, I guess you do in 1505. You call out to St. Anne to save you. So he calls out to St. Anne, the mother of Mary, the patron saint of his father's occupation. And he says, if you save my life, I'm going to be a monk. So sure enough, he lives. And later that month, he goes and joins an Augustinian monastery. And he just throws himself into the life of a monk. He's like monk par excellence. But he has this serious problem. He's got a really guilty conscience. He just can't shake the fact that he feels like he's not accepted by God, and there's nothing he can do. There's none of the monkish works, the scripture writing, the studying, the penance, all that stuff. He just can't do enough. So, I mean, he was crazy. He would walk up and down stone steps on his bare knees, trying to atone for his sins, trying to grovel and say how poor he was before God. He was notoriously a really good confessor, so he actually drove his superiors crazy. He would confess anything and everything. And eventually, after he earned his PhD, they just got so sick of him that they just kind of promoted him out of the monastery and said, you know what, you go be a professor at university. You've got this thing under control. So he does, and thankfully for us, while he's preparing a lecture one night in the tower, of all places, there's a tower at the university where he used to work. And like, the significance of these things in history is amazing. Like, you know, like the name of the Lord's a high tower, the righteous run to it and are saved. He's in a tower, and he's preparing to do a lecture on Romans. So he reads Romans 1, he reads, you know, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, it's the power of God for salvation, or the Jew first, also the Gentile. And he gets to Romans 1, 17. And he says, for in it, in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. The just shall live by faith. And this actually bothers him. This drives him crazy. He can't figure this out at all. He has a serious problem. And in his writings, he's talking about his relationship to God at this point in his life. And he says, I actually hated God. I hate this just God who would punish people. And we're already damned to hell, basically. So why would you keep punishing me over and over again for the sins that I'm committing? And he really had an issue. But one night, he's reading Romans chapter 1. He reads this. And then eventually, this is what he says in his words. He says, I meditated night and day on those words, the just shall live by faith, until at last, by the mercy of God, I paid attention to their context. The justice of God is revealed in it, as it is written, the just person lives by faith. I began to understand that in this verse, the justice of God, that is by that which the person lives by a gift of God, that is by faith. This is awesome. All at once I felt I had been born again, entered into paradise itself through open gates. I immediately saw the whole of Scripture in a different light. I ran through the Scriptures from memory and found that other terms had analogous meanings. The work of God, that is, what God works in us. The power of God by which he makes us powerful. The wisdom of God by which he makes us wise. The strength of God, the salvation of God, the glory of God. That's incredible. That's, you know, we don't take that for granted, but as Christians, we now would say, very openly, very proudly, we're saved by grace through faith. We understand this. We understand there's nothing that we can do to add to the work of God, and we can receive it. In his time, that is revolutionary, and that's enough to get you killed. Amen. It's unfortunate, but true. So to understand a little bit more, we'll look at the society. So this is the great man that is Luther, and in his society, why is this such a big deal? I mean, obviously, it's an eternally great deal, but in his time, the experience of a Christian in this time would be that you wouldn't know the Bible. The Bible's written in Latin. You weren't allowed to learn Latin unless you were a theologian, a professor, a priest. You would go to church, and your church experience would be, the underpinning theology behind your church experience is this. Everybody's a Christian because when you're a child, you're baptized. When you're baptized, your original sin is dealt with. So whatever you've inherited from Adam is gone. But then now that you're a Christian, now that you're saved, you've got this kind of scale that you're working on. So you can add good or you can add bad. And your bad can never be outdone by your good unless you take the merits of, say, a dead saint. Or, in some cases, Jesus himself. He can give you some grace so that your good can overweigh your bad. And that, it's very insidious. It's a very terrible play on the grace of God that is freely given. So the way that they would typically try to make up for the bad in their lives is they would attend a service where they'd attend the Mass, the Eucharist. And their understanding of the Lord's Supper was this, that the bread actually became the body of Jesus, the blood, the wine became the blood. But the thing about it was this, it was a celebration that was done on a table called the altar. And they didn't believe that the blood of Jesus and the broken body of Jesus at Calvary was enough. So weekly, the priest would re-sacrifice Jesus and make him suffer again, over and over and over again. And the book of Hebrews has a lot to say about this. That's just not how it is. Jesus sacrificed once and for all. He shed his blood once, and now he's seated at the right hand of God, waiting for his enemies to be made his footstool. One time, once and for all. So these people lived in a terrible mindset. They lived in a world that was terrible and dark and bleak. Like, you couldn't have your own relationship with God. It was through a priest. Everything you did was mediated through somebody else. So him saying something like, I had an encounter with God. God revealed himself to me. That's enough to get you killed. You can't know God. You can't know God outside of the priest. That's crazy. What are you talking about? And it's into this this society, this kind of understanding, this kind of worldview, a kind of worldview where if you're caught with a Bible in your own language, that could be death. You know, this is a time in history when you get excommunicated from the church. You buck the trend. You don't buy into what they're selling. You can't buy. You can't sell. You can't trade. You can't live. They estimate that between the year 350 and 1750, over 50 million Christians died. They were put to death for saying things like what Luther said. This is a really big deal if you understand the society. So along comes Martin Luther. He gets a revelation. He understands that he has a right relationship with God by faith alone. He understands the scope and the magnitude of the sacrifice of Jesus as once and for all. He understands that he's free. He's not beholden to priests. He's not beholden to a church apparatus that mediates his relationship to God, but he can experience God for himself. And into this society, he speaks and he writes, and he says things like this. Not only are we the freest of kings, we're also priests forever, which is far more excellent than being kings. For as priests, we're worthy to appear before God, to pray for others, and to teach one another divine things. These are the functions of priests, and they cannot be granted to any unbeliever. Thus Christ has made it possible for us, provided we believe in him, to not only be his brethren, co-heirs, and fellow kings, but also fellow priests. Therefore, we may boldly come into the presence of God in the spirit of faith and cry, Abba, Father, pray for one another and do all things which we see done and foreshadowed in the outer and visible works of priests. This is completely revolutionary. And so, you know, there's debate, Reformation, revival. What does Reformation have to do with revival? Well, Martin Luther had an encounter with God. You know, this isn't something that's known through history as accompanied with crazy manifestations of the Holy Spirit. But I want to say that, you know, you come to know Jesus Christ, that's by the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, you know, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you, but my Father which is in heaven. And on this rock I'll build my church, the rock of this revelation. Amen. And Martin Luther introduced again into the church, into the mainstream, into the public, the opportunity for relationship and encounter with God personally, by relationship, in an unmediated way through Jesus Christ alone. Now, the impacts of this across European society were vast. From this revelation, a lot of, we'll say, not spiritually minded people took the revelation and they ran with it, and they cheered Luther on and they said, great, good for you, that's awesome. Now I have a scriptural justification for abandoning the political order of the day. And so a lot of secular kings, they started their own kingdoms. They rebelled against the authority of the Pope. Probably a good thing historically, but at the time, the way it worked out, a lot of people died. Science emerges. All of a sudden, people are free to say, you know what? If the church got this wrong about Jesus, something so basic and so fundamental, what else do you got wrong? What else are you telling me that's wrong? I'm going to start looking into things for myself. So they started looking at the Bible themselves. They started looking at the world around them differently. So science, knowledge itself is completely transformed. Political systems are completely transformed. The revelation that Luther had, and one of the significant aspects of this, is he had a revelation that I am saved. I'm saved personally. Not because I've been born into a society, not because I was baptized as a kid or because of my citizenship or my parents, but me personally, I've had faith in Jesus Christ and I have become saved. And this is completely revolutionary as well. In a time where all of society is ordered, with the system, the structure, the level that you're born into is where you stay, there's no upward or downward mobility. The whole of society is seen as ordered by God. So the fact that somebody can come along and say, you know what, I myself personally have had an encounter with God, a relationship with him through Jesus Christ by my faith, not by what a priest tells me, not by what anyone else says, completely blows out the lid on the whole of society, completely transforms the religious system of the time. Politics, like I said, science, knowledge, it's all completely gone. And one of the things, too, that I wanted to say about this as well, so we've got the great man theory, we've got the society, but also the legacy that it left. Last week, we talked about the Wesley brothers, Whitfield. We talked about the Pietists. So it would be wrong to say that before the Reformation, there's nobody who has this understanding. God's always had his people somewhere, you know? So Elijah is complaining, and he says, you know, God, I'm the only one left. And God says, no, I've reserved 7,000 who haven't bowed the knee. And that's really important, you know? We're never the only people in town who've got it. There's always somebody somewhere hidden. God has his people, and he's had his people throughout history. But there came a point in time where God decided, you know what, I've raised up a person, this is the time, and he moved and he did something. And you know, I think about in Revelation 10, there's an angel, he comes and he's got his feet on the water, he's got his feet on the land, he speaks with a voice that sounds like the voice of a lion. There's seven thunders that roar, and the voice says, there'll be delay no longer. It's almost as if throughout history, this hidden group of people who were persecuted and put to death for remaining faithful to the true gospel of God, God raises up a champion. And the way he does it, I love it. It's so beautiful. It's a guy in a tower preparing a lecture at a university who gets a revelation in his heart of Jesus Christ. Fire didn't fall from heaven, but something happened in his heart. Like we learned about the Wesleys, there was a warming in the heart. And the potential for this is absolutely amazing. I think about, you know, what does this mean for me? What does that mean for us? What does it mean for us to get into our secret place or whatever with the Lord? What does it mean for him to let him speak to us, to let him breathe the mysteries of who he is? And even the basic things of the gospel, you know, in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith in the gospel. And it was the preaching of the gospel that really got Martin Luther and that changed the course of history. So society changes, we've got great men rising up, and we've got a court of people. The Reformation kind of broke off. So we have the magisterial reformers like Luther, Zwingli, Calvin. These people wanted to marry the revelation they had of God with secular power and secular authority. So we get people like John Calvin in Geneva who are saying, this is the revelation, the word of God now, the Bible, we're elevating it above the opinion of the popes, and we're gonna build a society based on the word of God. So all of a sudden, secular laws, legislation is passed, everything is passed to try and conform to the Bible. But you've got another group of people called the Radical Reformers, and they decide, you know what? What we need is the Holy Spirit. What we need is a revolution in our hearts. We don't need society to be transformed by laws. We need the Spirit of God in our hearts moving us. And this is the legacy of the people who had become the Pietists, the people completely devoted to relationship with God through faith in Jesus and an experiential nature, a tangible encounter with the Spirit of God. And this is the legacy that would move into people like Wesley, Whitfield. And so throughout history, you've got this strand of people, these invisible people who are being murdered, killed, condemned. And then you get to Luther, and Luther kind of brings it all out to the fore. And then from Luther, there's a breakaway. And then you've got this thread of people, Pietists, and then you get the First Great Awakening, the Second Great Awakening, you get the Pentecostal revivals in the 1900s into the healing revivals of the 50s, the Jesus movement. There's just this beautiful, like they call it the golden thread through history of the move of God. And this is just an extremely significant and wonderful example of how God raises up a person by revelation. You know, the great theory, you know, it has its flaws. But God also uses men. He exalts men. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, and in due time, he will lift you up. But he lifted him up through the revelation of his son.
Amen. What was that line you said? The man of Reformation? No, there's a line that just struck me there. Holy Spirit, bring it back to me. Well, that's great. Thank you, Zach. Yeah, great men. Great men. God uses great men, but the thing is, he's made them great. He's revealed his revelation. He's given revelation to them. And we all know Bobby, so Bobby, why don't you bring your great revelation? Or the present awakening that you were already prepared to talk about.
Well, geez. Zach, that was just phenomenal. That was, I could listen to you past my time. Would you want to come back? No, seriously, was that not awesome? That was incredible. And I never knew, I mean, I knew you're off at seminary. I knew you're up there, but it's been awesome. Hey, I've already gone down that road, but it was really phenomenal. So thank you so much for that. So what a crazy day it's been for us or for me. And I was in Montreal this morning and made it back in 6.5 hours. I was flying, man. I was flying down that 401. And so it was really awesome. So I'm going to talk a little bit about, what revival has, meant to me. And I think, in our whole, or at least my past experience is one there. I was the immovable one. I was the 10 pin. I was the concrete pillar. I was the pillar of the assemblies. My favorite song was, I shall not be moved. I mean, I wasn't going down for anybody. You can have anybody pray for me. It wasn't happening. But how many know deep inside every one of us there is a hunger, there's a desire, there is a wick waiting to be lit. And when that wick is lit, something out of the ordinary is gonna happen. You know what happens? The unseen comes in the scene. So that when you jump on the scene, something is seen. Something out of the ordinary, which is really the ordinary, but for those of you who don't know about it, it's really weird. And it's extraordinarily weird. But for myself, I was so hungry for really what God wanted to do, in my own life, that I had to just get out of my own way. And I kind of think some of us may need to do that too. We want so much, but we need to get out of our own understanding, and we need to get out of our own way and step. Because sometimes, we are our greatest obstacle. We are our greatest wall. Somebody said one time, Satan's greatest opposition comes at the point of your breakthrough. If you've never met the devil face to face, chances are you're traveling in the same direction he is. Amen. And how many of us, knowing or unknowingly, we kind of go down that road, but we always had that hunger. And so, what was the first thing you were going to tell me? I just had a brain fart. Anyway, so it was about, I know what it was. So Cheryl and I were three things that happened for us. So we were in Windsor one time, and we were singing some of the things I can remember this afternoon. We were singing this song called "Sweet Wind." There's a wind blowing. Yeah, remember that one? And so we were. I was doing this high school assembly, and everybody was supposed to come back that night, and for this great big rally. And so we're singing "Sweet Wind," and there's all sorts of different faiths that had come into that auditorium. And we had no idea what God was. I mean, we had our agenda, but we didn't know what God's agenda was going to be. And so we just started singing a song, but there was some sauce on that song. And so whenever she would sing the thing, then God would just show up. And it was so cool because we're there, and all of a sudden we're singing a song, and then all the kids are on the ground. And so you have the Baptist kids there, and the Mennonite kids, and Pentecostal kids. I mean, they're all there. People walked into the auditorium and said that it felt like they walked into a giant waterfall. I didn't know what was going on. Sometimes, how many know, sometimes you may not always experience it yourself when you're delivering, but when the word is released, then something out of the ordinary happens. And so we're singing "Sweet Wind," and God just, he just shows up all over the place. And I thought, this is going to be the one experience that I can take to Toronto, and I can get on the stage. And I can have the big kahuna himself, John or not, lay a whammy on me. Because now I've got a story. Because everybody went there with stories, and I didn't have a story. I was just the Pentecostal Assembly's ordained guy. There's no story there. And so we had this cool story. So we went there, and I said, I wanted John to pray for me. And unfortunately, John was out of town. So they brought the youth pastor in. I didn't want that guy. I wanted the big kahuna. So I get the youth pastor with a hot dog coming out of the cafeteria with mustard dripping down his shirt. And I'm like, I don't want that guy. I want the big kahuna. Well, this guy prays for me, and I don't remember anything other than being, I mean, it was like a flying walrus, boom, right on the ground. And so I was down there, and I had this whole pride thing going on. And I can hear in my subconscious, there was a pastor, Barry Boucher. Barry Boucher from Ottawa, he was there. And I know that young man down there. And in the back of my mind, I'm laying on the ground going, dang it, somebody knows me. That's even bad because I'm the pillar of the assemblies. I don't fall down, but boom, it happened. Well, here's the cool part about that, because I thought that I was getting some kind of impartation for ministry. And I think it might have been maybe a selfish motivation, but I thought I was getting something for ministry. Little did I know that it was going to, that impartation, if you will, was going to take a whole different road. So we went down to Connecticut to minister to my dad. He had colon cancer, lung cancer, bone cancer, had cancer. I mean, he was just lit up. And he was on his deathbed. And my dad was solid Catholic, would just went to church Christmas and Easter. And he was just not the savable guy. It just wasn't happening. And so Cheryl piped up and said, you know, would you like to give your life to Christ? How many know there's only two things you really think about on your deathbed is eternity and your children. And so Cheryl said, would you like to give your life to Christ? And he said, yeah, you would. And I said, well, you would? Why? You never did when I asked, but you did when she asked. So she's nicer. And so he prayed. So here's the cool thing. He gave his heart to the Lord. He had another year left on his life. But I went back to Toronto because now I said, well, this, you know, I'm going to go back and get some more, right? What I didn't know was this, that the impartation that I thought I was getting for supernatural platform ministry wasn't that at all. Because the worship leader, Dan Catrona was there, and he came over to me and he said, I was there when they prayed for you that night. I said, oh, great, good. You saw all that, the twitching and the shaking and the convulsing and all that kind of stuff that was not going to happen to me. And he said, oh, by the way, I thought I'd let you know that we were praying. I said, oh, really? He said, yeah, we were praying that God would give you everything you needed to minister to your dad. And then my dad gave his heart to the Lord. And see, that was the beginning of hunger and more. Because I'm thinking, you know, God, if you can do that that way, what can you do on a larger scale? And so we had a desire. I think we were up in Collingwood, Ontario, and I don't know what year it was, 2008, 7. And they were singing some Irish song. It didn't mean anything to me before that, but for whatever reason, they started singing this Irish song, and I started crying. I started getting a burden for the homeland, you know. And so I didn't know anybody in Ireland. I didn't know nothing. I didn't know a pastor. I just Googled pastors in Ireland. So I found, you know, guys, and I said, just told them, hey, I just had this dream, had this desire, you know, to come and minister into the land of my heritage. And so there's a couple people who took a risk, and we, you know, we went down in March, and it was awesome. But here's where it got really interesting, because God just really put just a hunger for the homeland. It's kind of crazy, you know, whatever your heritage is, it could be Italy, it could be Ireland, it could be Poland, whatever the case is, that when you go back to the land of your heritage, sometimes you feel like you're home. And so when I went back to Ireland, I was in Belfast, and I didn't know that the rift was still kind of going on. And so I stood there before a whole bunch of pastors in Belfast, and I said, you know, God's called me to minister into the land of my heritage in Ireland. And they all stood up, not to applaud me, but they stood up and said, "Aye, if you want to go out and minister to the land of your heritage, you're certainly not going to do it here. You need to go do it down there." And I'm like, oh, so this isn't Ireland. Oh, I thought it was Ireland, but it was Northern Ireland. That's not Ireland. Belfast is Ireland. This is just glorified England. And I was like, oh, we're in the wrong hole here. So I need to be in the green land, not the orange land. My bad. I thought this was one great big country. The point of it is this. I went back, and that was March, and I went back to Lakeland was just starting to happen. And we had ministered at Ignited Church the previous October for four nights. And it was awesome, man. It was just this great blow up and just this incredible breakthrough happening. And they wanted to see if we can get Todd to, you know, come. And anyway, we worked it out. So I came back from Ireland in March. And I'm there in the meetings in April, I think it was, right? And so I'm just sitting there. No one knew much of anything. And then a guy named Brent Borthwick came over. Brent, we had known him. He was Todd's pastor, I think, in Abbotsford or something like that. Anyway, I had just come back from Ireland. He didn't know that. And he says, hey, I see you ministering to the East Coast. I said, oh, yeah, well, that's nice. Because I was thinking Connecticut, Maine. I was like, who wants to go there? You know, he's the East Coast. He said, no, I, you know, East, like past the East, like the ocean, East. I said, really? That's kind of weird. He said, because I just got back from Ireland. He said, yeah, but I see you not only ministering in Ireland, but in Scotland too. And remember those two phrases, Ireland and Scotland too. I said, oh, okay, that's cool. But I didn't think nothing of it because it was just somebody coming over and having another one of those words, right? And so I was like, okay, whatever. So all this kind of circus was going on at Lakeland. And I came around the backside of the platform there, and all the little people who want to rub up against Todd and get, you know, position, they're all jockeying for position. So I was over here, and then Todd looked at me like this, and then he says, Bobby Sullivan! How he does. Bobby, I see you going to Ireland and Scotland too. And as soon as he said that, man, I fat boy dove like back like that, boom, hit the ground, and it was awesome. But the point of it was he said Ireland and Scotland too. When he did that, then something was ignited on the inside because there just happened to be a pastor from Scotland there, Richard Iredale. Richard came over and Brian Madden from Belfast, and they both came over and they said, we want you to come to Ireland and Scotland. Now, here's the launching pad. Because prior to that, it was just hunger. But the hunger was starting. How many know when you get so hungry and there's a rumbling and you're tumbling? I mean, you're so hungry and nothing really satisfies. There's things that'll fill the gap, but nothing that really satisfies. And it got to a point like you just had to go. So I get over there. Get this, I'm not into the big revival thing. I'm still reading about it pretty much. You know, I've done and dabbled in this and that, but not on a grand scale like that. And I was scared out of my wazoo. So I get over there to Scotland, and they're expecting Jesus. I mean, you know, they're expecting stuff. And I was like, holy. So remember the old thing, God's looking for what? Availability, not ability, right? So I get over there, and the first three nights, there's 3,000 people there. And I'm in the back green room, literally green, freaking out. I'm like, holy, these people are expecting Jesus. They want Todd. They want this. And then I'm me. How many know when you get onto a platform, how many people are always looking for a platform without a price? And so I knew that I was willing to pay the price. I didn't know what it would cost me later on. And so we got out there, and there was miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle. I preached 34 nights in a row. It was nuts. People were driving 5 hours just to come to church. So the gym was filled, the annex was filled, they televised it, and it went on and on and on. And then every spot that, this is the cool thing, every spot that I had to go to in this little itinerary, word got out, word got out, word got out. And then it was nuts. We went down to Athlone in the middle of Ireland, and the Archbishop of the Diocese of Dublin, he endorsed all the meetings. Now, there was 500 people, which may not sound a lot to you, but for 500 people in Ireland, in the middle of Athlone, that's a predominantly Catholic stronghold, that's a bunch of people. And these meetings were going nuts. I haven't seen anything quite like that. And I'm to the point where, you know, throwing a blanket and people are getting plastered, hammered, dragging them out like a bunch of crazy fool drunks, which was kind of normal for the country, but it was really different down there. It was happening, and it was happening, and it was happening. It got to a point where we were in Coleraine, anyway, someplace. And I remember Todd saying something about how the glory of God can get so strong that it's almost like a sinkhole, like a holy spot, like an angelic visitation. And my conservative backbone, I wasn't going to say, well, an angel is here, or, you know, that kind of like either. But I would always say, you know, the presence of the Lord is so thick here. I figured I can be safe there saying that. But I'd always remember him saying, you know, step into here and you'll feel it. So there was a place in this church. And there was like, I think, four nights, and it was 600-800 people showing up. And I really felt God was doing some stuff. And I said, oh, let's just have fun and see what happens. And so I remember stepping in this pothole. And it was just like, I would just react. Everybody reacts differently, but I was reacting, and it was crazy. And I told Cheryl, I said, come step here. She's like, no. But it was so cool because it didn't matter what happened. How many know when you're in that realm and you're in that zone and you're in that glory and you're under that bubble, and you're under that kingdom, the king's domain, the dome of the king, when you're in that, stuff happens. It was weird. The pastor, I don't feel this. The pastor's looking at me, and he's just looking, fell out. I'm like, what's wrong with you? He just fall out. And they went to give me the mic. I went to grab the mic. I touched the mic, and they all fall out. I'm the only one standing. I'm like, what's up with that? Oh, yeah. Well. So finally, the youth pastor, she comes, and she tries to grab the mic, and she goes flying. It didn't matter because there came a point where I got you get so filled with God that you're like a faithful, a geyser, and you get so full that you have to lay your hands on something or you'll explode. And it didn't matter, dog, dead cat. I mean, it don't matter. You got to lay your hands on me. I mean, you have to lay your hands on something just to release the pressure. And it was just so cool what was happening. And it didn't matter who came in. It didn't matter what the miracle was, what the healing was. It didn't matter what the religious background. It was the Church of England, Church of Ireland. You know, it didn't matter. They all came in the monkey suits. They all came in their stuff. It didn't matter because there was a hunger in them that was probably stronger than the hunger that I had. But it all came out of the availability. We went to this little church. I'll almost end with this. So we went to this little church, and it was like the end of the tour. And there's only like 25 people there. And they come in with the big blankets, the swords, like, you know, King Bob. And they said, this is the weird part now. They said, you're the apostolic father that we have been praying for this land. I'm like, dude, listen, man, I just came here to preach some messages. You know, I'm not the apostolic father. And they're like, no. He said, you're going to put one foot on England and the other foot on Ireland. And he said, it's your apostolic calling. It's going to pull the sides together. I'm like, that is a heavy. Especially when you're not used to this kind of stuff. I mean, that's a heavy. You're like, oh, I'm going to die doing this. But it was really kind of cool, the authority that God places upon you when you just say, hey, I'm going. I'll do it. And so let me end with this. So that carried on for months and months and months and months. And then we planted this church in Mount Bridges. And that was fun. But how many know sometimes when you're pastoring, you don't really step a whole lot into this glory thing because you're pastoring. And so I get a call from Todd. And he says, now I haven't done any of this kind of glory stuff in 5 years. He says, hey, I want you to come to South Africa and help me steward the revival. I'm like, well, what is that? What does that mean? I hope he wasn't going to say preach. Because I didn't think I was really ready for that. Because I was pastoring. But he said, no, I want you to just come and catch some people. He said, you need to get into the glory again. I said, oh, I can catch some folks. That's good. So the weird thing about it is about 4 days before I was going down, then I had this whole anxiety thing. I was like, Africa, I'm not coming back. I'm going to end up in somebody's bowl of soup. I'm not coming back. South Africa, I'm a big fat boy. There's a lot of meat on these bones. I'm going to be a big bowl. And all these crazy thoughts. I was crying. I'm crying. I'm going through all this stuff. It was the longest plane ride ever, literally. So I get there, and here's what happens. So I get there. God TV is showing the whole thing. I'm stink, man. I just get off 30-something hours on the flight, right? And I walk into the sanctuary because the stuff is happening, and Todd's up there preaching away, and he sees me come over here. He goes, ladies and gentlemen, Bobby Sullivan just showed up from Canada. I'm like, God, people are going to fall under the wrong power. Don't even introduce me now. So he says, we're sending Bobby to Worcester, South Africa to do the meetings. I was like, wait, hang on, Tonto. You told me I'm coming to catch people. But he said, no, we're going to send you because I can't go. So you're going to go and represent Fresh Fire and bring the glory to Worcester, South Africa. And how many realize at that time, there's no time to get nervous at all. And so I had a couple messages. I had a few things just in case. So I get there. Little did I know what God had in store. Because how many know, just because you may not be moving in it, it doesn't mean it ever leaves. And what was crazy is there was 40 churches that came together in Worcester, South Africa. There was 3,000 people there that night. And these people, the mayor was there, pomp, hoopla, South African celebration, dancing, carrying on. And they're waiting for the man of God to show up. And I was waiting for him to show up too, because I didn't think it was me. And so all these cats, they're all praying and releasing the power and all this. I'm not feeling jack, man. I'm more scared than anything. I'm like, and I'm looking at the clock going, you know, let there be a supernatural increase in hours and get this thing over with, because I really just came down here to pray for some people and not just go off, right? So here's the cool part. When he said, ladies and gentlemen, you know, here's Bobby, and he gives me the mic, it was almost like the compression of time. And it was everything that had been bottled up and stored up for 5 years. It was just like, and as soon as he grabbed me the mic, as soon as he gave me the mic, it was like authority came back. Anointing came back. There were more blind people healed than I've ever seen. More deaf people. Even Todd and the staff, they said, you know what? You have a 90% success rate in people, in deaf people getting healed instantly. And I'm like, really? And it was just really weird seeing how all this was happening. But it was stuff that has been building up and building up and building up. And that lasted for a week. And people kept coming and coming and coming. And what was happening is that we were releasing something significant in the atmosphere, because your words have an assignment attached to them. Every word that comes out of your mouth has an assignment. It has a destination. It's like a missile looking for a place to explode. Power is the inherited ability to perform in the realms of the unknown. It has sudden explosive capabilities, so that even though you might feel insignificant, useless, helpless, and worthless, that whenever you grab the mic and you're speaking his word, then something out of the ordinary begins to take place. And so this kept going on and on and on. Anyway, we stayed there for 3 weeks. And it didn't matter if there was demonic stuff going on. It was just ridiculous what all was happening. So I know I've kind of gone on probably over my time, but revival has really significantly helped us and changed us and shifted us, and it has put us in a realm, has put us on a platform that, you know, we really just dreamt about, I guess. And then, you know, Lakeland happens, and, you know, we're a part of that, and being a part of, I think the coolest thing with Lakeland, some of you were there when we were at Tiger Stadium. And it was just getting too full. And we're at Tiger Stadium. Todd says, we're going to pray for all 10,000 people. I said, you're smoking dope. How are we going to do that? I mean, we're already flipping exhausted. We pray for everything that has moved in, you know, the Civic Center. He said, oh, no, we're going to pray for 10,000 people, Bobby. I said, all right. So he lines all these characters around the what do you call it? The track, the warning track, whatever it's called, on the thing. And then there's a few of us in the middle, and we're going in between. And it's just like Machine Gun City. Three times around, and they pray for 10,000 people. So I'm just saying, it's really kind of cool to see what happens when you just say, God, hey, I'm ready to go. And you just never really know what platform that God's going to put you on. And when he puts you on the platform, he's not going to take you off. He's not going to, because that's your platform. That's your opportunity to speak. It's your opportunity to shine. It's your opportunity to be in your glory. It's his glory, but it's still your glory. That's why people say, boy, you're in your zone. You're in your glory. You're in your realm. You know, you're in there, because how many know that's where he wants you to be? When you're there, things happen. When you're not out of there, nothing happens, or not much happens. So with that, that's kind of our, did I miss anything? You're staring at me looking at me. Oh.
Give it to Geoff. Well, thank you. I was kind of hoping you'd carry on, because this is not my element. So I'm going to receive that stepping out into new realms. My job is to sit at the back, and when Pastor Carl makes a good point, go, amen. But I was thinking about when Pastor Carl asked me to come tonight and share. I was actually thinking testimony as well and different things, and I think part of it is, if you knew where I came from, because a lifetime ago, I was a long-haired, drunken pothead, going nowhere fast, and like literally, I've said it before and I'll say it again, if it wasn't for Jesus, I'd have either been dead or in prison or died in prison by now. There's no way I would have got to where I am today. And I actually got saved during the first Gulf War because someone had given me a book and goes totally against this book, Pastor Carl's Theology on Eschatology. It was Late Great Planet Earth. And there's things in that now that I don't know if I totally agree with, but the bottom line was, God can use anything to get you. And what that book did was got me reading the Bible. And then reading the Bible, I didn't know at the time, was fellowshipping with Jesus. And Jesus revealed himself to me in such a way that I was actually on my way out to buy some pot one night. And I was living out in a small town, Fenland Falls. I don't know if you know where that is, up in the Kawarthas. I was driving across to another town over near Lake Simcoe where I knew a guy. Anyway, I'm on this county road, which is the busiest county road between Fenland Falls and Beaverton, which is over near Lake Simcoe. It's about 25 below that night, and I'm driving along, and just everything that I've been thinking, that I've been reading, that I'd been seeing on the news, everything was all welling up in me, and I just knew that I knew that I knew that there had to be something more. So I stopped the car, stepped out of the car, and I leaned against the hood, lit a cigarette, because I smoked like a chimney, and I just remember standing there, and I said, God, Jesus, Holy Spirit, I don't know who you are, I don't know how you work together. All I know is I've screwed my life up and I want you in it. And that instant, I knew that I knew that I knew that the Bible was true, that God was real. Because even though it was like 20, 25 below that night, and I'm standing out, it was, you know, those cold, clear, crisp winter nights out in the country where like there's like a bazillion stars up in the sky. I felt a warm blanket of love descend on me. And I kind of looked up into the star, and I saw the stars, and I had like 25 minutes, me and God. I was bawling my eyes out, hoping to God an OPP didn't come along, because he would really wonder what I was doing. But it was me and God for like 20 minutes on the side of the busiest county road, and nobody drove by. But I fast forward a bit, because I ended up, I knew I had to go to church. I just knew. But I kept reading my Bible. And going to church, I learned doubt and unbelief. One church I went to, the pastor, who had been a paratrooper in the Canadian Army and was going for surgery, so I said to him, hey, let's pray. Because I know it says, where two or more agree is touching anything, it shall be done. That all those who came to Jesus, he healed. I know that whatsoever you ask the Father in the name of the Son, he will give it to you. That if the word abides in you and you abide in me, you shall ask whatsoever you will. And it shall be done. Well, Geoff, God doesn't always answer prayers the way we want. So I said, well, how about we pray that God touches the surgeon, moves his hands, that you have a supernatural recovery, and you'll be back up and preaching in no time. Yeah, I can agree with that. So we prayed. He supernaturally recovered. He was back up and preaching in no time. It was a miracle as far as he was concerned. But I learned that what I read in the Word, what I sensed from the Spirit, to not look at men because they might distract me from what the Word said. So when I started experiencing and encountering revival, as we see with the people laughing, the people falling out, and the people, because I was very much an my personality type, I think, is an ENTJ. And the last two or three are intuitive, thinking, and judgmental. And I could be really thinking and judgmental. And I'm looking at these nut bars going, are you serious? Give me a break, right? And now there were times that God touched me. because I there's a scripture in Isaiah. Actually, I got it right here. We all know from glory to glory. We all want to go from glory to glory. But we all, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory. And we want that. But I also knew in Isaiah 28 where it said, for precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little. Right? So I was building everything on the word. But it was works-based. Very good that I was building up what was in my spirit and coming out. What I didn't know at the time when I'm sitting judging people, because I would see them go absolute crazy and wonderful and falling out, but then I'd see them turn around and it was like an emotional high, like the guy who was drunk had, you know, unless they were going for another drunk, they just weren't the same. And they didn't seem to, it didn't seem to have an effect on their lives, right? And so I would judge. And I would try and reconcile that with the scripture where Matthew said, or Jesus said, and I believe it's in Matthew, judge not lest you be judged, for which the measure which you meet shall be measured back unto you. So I'd say, okay, fine. I'd step back. Because the thing is that struck me was not seeing the change in them. And over the 25 years, I started coming to the realization. And I love the way Andrew Womack has taught it, is spirit, soul, and body. That you are a spirit, that you have a soul, and you live in a body. And when you get born again, where 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, all things are become new, that's in your spirit realm. So it's your spirit that's sanctified, set free, and made perfect. It's your spirit that's going to heaven. Your soul is your mind, your mental thinking, your brain. Your brain is the hardware. The thinking is the software that your brain works on. That's your mind and your emotions. And I see so many people that are emotion-led, that emotions can lie to you. You got to reside in what's in your spirit. And so I would sit there and I would look, and I still to this day, I look at the scriptures in Ephesians, because that same pastor who told me that, you know, be careful, God's not always going to give you what you ask. He also told me tongues was of the devil. He also told me that Kenneth Copeland guy, be careful. But he did say one thing to me. Because I was at the time still looking at a lot of eschatology. I was reading all kinds of stuff. And he said, Geoff, it doesn't matter. Right? And since then, I've become a pan-eschatologist. I'm going to see how it pans out. Right? But he said to me, "What if you want to study the Bible, read the epistles. See what it takes to be the best Christian that you can be." So he had a lot of things wrong, but he had one thing right. And so that's what I did. And I found in Ephesians 4:22, I got 4:22 to 28 here, but that you put off concerning your former conduct the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. That you put on the new man which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. So your new man is your spirit. Put on that man, put him into your natural mind. Renew your mind in accordance with Romans 12:2, with the word of God. Renew your mind, let the spirit man take over the soulish man. Your thinking, the old carnal thinking that when somebody comes against you, you want to hit him. The spirit man says, love him. The body, the flesh, will decay, die, and rot away. Your spirit man is forever. We live out of our spirit. There's a number of references to that. Another translation, and I forgot to write down which one it was, says the new man created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. That's your spirit. Colossians 3:10. and have put on the new man, who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him. We're all created by God. Verse 12, those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion. It's a choice that we have to make. Put on this spirit man. Yes, we're born again. Yes, we're going to heaven. And my confusion over the years was that it was works. I got to put on the new man. I got to put on the new man. It's the glory of God within me. He does the work. I just have to choose. Like Deuteronomy 28, no. 30, 19, and 20 says, and it's under the curse, you know. I set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Choose life, right? Well, that was the old covenant. That was then. In choosing life, we just let him flow through us. But we're the, you know, we can limit the Holy One of Israel. That's what he said to the people of the Old Testament when they were coming out in Exodus. They limited the Holy One of Israel. We can do the same thing because he's a gentleman. So when we press in, when we want revival, when we want, God's going to meet us. He is going to just knock our socks off. But afterwards, tomorrow, the next day, when the honeymoon's over, same thing with a marriage. When the honeymoon's over, you still love your wife. And then you have another honeymoon. Hopefully. But you keep going. You don't just go for the high, you go for the long haul. That's my opinion. I'm in this for the long haul. And I've chosen to put on the new man. Are there days I've blown it? Absolutely. But afterwards, whoops, should have chose the new man. You know? And Romans 6:6, knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him in order our body of sin might be done away with, that's the physical, that we would no longer be slaves to sin. Romans 13:14, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in regard to its lusts. Because in John 15:3, he says, you are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. We are clean. And this is great the way God does it, because now I'm going to have to come up with some new stuff for communion. Thank you very much, Zach. And you're talking about gifts and callings and the words that were spoken over you. Because in choosing to put on the new man, the gifts and callings of God are without repentance. Those are things that he's putting in you, put in you. They're there. And you can choose to let them lay dormant, or 1 Timothy 4:14, do not neglect your gift, which was given you through prophecy when the body of elders laid their hands on you. 2 Timothy 1:16, for this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of hands. So it's there. If you're born again, you got the Spirit of God residing inside you. The kingdom of God is inside you, which is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. The sacrifice was done once. We don't continuously work to get cleansed of our sin. We don't continuously work to get God to love us. But we do have to remind ourselves sometimes daily to choose to walk in the gifts and callings that he's placed within us. And it might be 5 years, and then it's going to burst out of you like a geyser. But we just got to choose. So, worship team, if we'd like to enter into worship, come on forward. And what I said, and I said to Bill just before the service, because I was meditating on this scripture. We don't know all the prayers that were prayed over you in the past, prophecies that have been said over you in the past, but we're going to trust. So Bobby, Bill, we can pray for people. You come forward. Let's get into a spirit of worship. Why don't we, the last song that we sang, we'll start with that. All right. Why don't we come forward, come into worship, and then we'll just, when you feel led, Bobby, Bill, just start praying for people. And if a word of knowledge comes, if prayer comes, if a prophecy comes, we'll just let her rip. Amen. Amen.